Greetings. I believe most people have heard the story of Jonah. I was discussing it this morning and had some interesting observations. Jesus was being challenged to produce a sign. Matthew 12:38. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees said to him, "Teacher, we want to see a sign from you." Demanding a sign is a test to prove God is endorsing the prophet. This is not the only time they did this, demanding a sign to test God. Matthew 16:1. Then the Pharisees and Sadducees came and tested Jesus by asking him to show them a sign from heaven. Luke 11:15. And some of them said, "By Beelzebul, the prince of the demons, he casts out the demons." And others tested him by demanding a sign from heaven. This is the same reason Jews and Christians tested Muhammad. But that is an issue for another video. Jesus was being tested, challenged, to produce a sign. And this time Jesus gave an answer instead of a sign. Matthew 12:39. And answering, he said to them, "An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, and no sign will be given to it except..." And this is where my mind went, aha! Jesus did not reference the sign of the 7-year bamboo. Jesus did not say he would go into the ground like a bamboo seed and rise again in 7 years. Jesus did not reference the grain of wheat that enters the ground and produces more. That could have been consistent because Jesus did talk elsewhere about the seed going into the ground. John 12:24. "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." And we know Jesus was using this verse to refer to his impending death. From the previous verse, John 12:23, "And Jesus answered them, saying, 'The hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified.'" No, when pressed for a sign, Jesus answered with the sign of Jonah. I guess it's lucky that the story of Jonah happened, right? I mean, it is almost like God had planned it in the distant past. I won't read all 4 chapters of Jonah in this video, but I will give you the salient points because they should be pondered. Jonah chapter 1. God wants to save Nineveh, and God commands Jonah to go to them and warn them. Jonah 1:1. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai. "Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me." God always wants to save men. 1 Timothy 2:3. "This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth." 2 Peter 3:9. "The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some understand slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." And Jonah knew this. Jonah 3:10. "When God saw what they did, the Ninevites, and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened." But to Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he, Jonah, became angry. He prayed to the Lord, "Isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? That is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you were a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity." Jonah knew God would forgive a repentant Nineveh. So Jonah ran away instead of obeying God. "That is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish." The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, "Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Do you think that somehow caught God by surprise? Do you think the heavens resounded with the thunderclap of a head slap? Duh! Didn't see that one coming. Give that a moment to sink in. God knew Jonah would run. God knew why Jonah would run. And God wanted to save Nineveh. Now, who do you think might make a more convincing argument to shock and awe Nineveh into repentance? An angry prophet who really wanted to see them die for their sins? Someone whose passion and anger was not necessarily a righteous anger, seeking their freedom from sin? Would Nineveh listen to such a raging fool? Or would they dismiss him as an angry fool, an insane man? God could check his box. Yep, I warned them. Knew they wouldn't listen, damned fools. But send Nineveh a man vomited up on a beach. A man possibly bleached by stomach acid. A man who perhaps looked like a ghost. Maybe Jonah even looked like death itself. I'd say God gave it the perfect effort to shock Nineveh into repentance. But that kind of means the fish taxi was not an accident. God could have picked another man, less hateful toward Nineveh, who would have obeyed and gone. God picked Jonah, who God knew would run away, so that God could send the fish taxi. Jonah 1:17. Now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. And Nineveh could be saved from destruction. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. The Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. And God did all this knowing that Jesus, the Son of God, would one day refer to the sign of Jonah. Not the sign of the grain of wheat, not the sign of the 7-year bamboo, the sign of Jonah, 3 days and nights in the belly of the fish. And along the way, God saved Nineveh. Know that you know that you know. God loves the lost and dying world. 1 Timothy 2:4, God who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some understand slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. That means sinners, people you might call pagans, heathens, or unbelievers. Christ died for their sins just like for yours. Share the gospel, the good news, with everyone. Don't sweat the persecution and the death. If they cut your head off, you're home. 1 Corinthians 15:55. O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? You lose, Satan. The Son of God has defeated you. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.